Here is Bob Dyke in Tehran.
This picture tells it all. This flag was apparently taken from someone's office inside the United States Embassy. It was burned Tuesday evening outside the embassy's gates. To the Iranian demonstrators who set fire to it, this was a symbol of victory. We have thrown out the occupiers. But instead of chasing all the Americans out of the compound, the Iranians imprisoned them in a building somewhere on these grounds. They have been hostages ever since. This morning, for the first time since the hostages were put under lock and key, one of the captives, blindfolded, was brought out into the open.
This is Harry Rosen, the embassy's press attaché.
He was turned to face reporters and cameramen and several hundred Iranian demonstrators outside the embassy's gates. "Yankee, go home," they cried, but they made no attempt to harm him. Eventually, he was led back to join the other captives who have been kept out of sight.
Every corner of the world, nations and people have voiced their strong revulsion and condemnation of Iran and have joined us in calling for the release of the hostages.
The events of the Iran hostage crisis are generally believed to have begun on one fateful day in 1979. However, the true origin of the crisis stems all the way back to the year 1953. At this time, Iran was ruled by Shah Reza Pahlavi, who was currently in a tense power struggle with Prime Minister Mossadegh. Mossadegh believed in and fought for the nationalization of Iran's oil supply, whereas the Shah believed in the westernization of Iran, gaining immense American support. With this new support, a plan was soon devised to overthrow the Prime Minister from power, which was successfully accomplished after the 1953 coup d'etat. 1978. Over many years, the Shah soon became an island of stability in the Middle East and a symbol of Iranian disapproval, resulting in harsh riots. February 1st, 1979. After many years of exile, the Ayatollah finally returns to Iran to take control of the now chaotic country. With great hesitation, the Shah is finally given clearance to come to the United States to seek cancer treatment, resulting in Iranian uproar.
Actions of Iran have shocked the civilized world. For a government to applaud mob violence and terrorism, for a government actually to support and in effect participate in the taking and the holding of hostages is unprecedented in human history.
We continue to face a grave situation in Iran where our embassy has been seized and more than 60 American citizens continue to be held as hostages in an attempt to force unacceptable demands on our country.
These unacceptable demands were the turning over of the Shah to Iran's now chaotic government to face trial and possible execution. November 17th, 1979. The Ayatollah orders the release of 13 hostages who he claims were oppressed by the United States due to their race and sex. The Canadian Caper. On November 4th, while hundreds of Iranian protesters stormed the U.S. Embassy and over 60 American citizens were taken captive, six American diplomats evaded capture. And after seeking refuge within several other embassies throughout Tehran, they were welcomed into the home of Canadian Ambassador Kenneth Taylor. Soon, Agent Tony Mendez and the CIA devise a plan in which they depict that the diplomats are a film crew shooting a sci-fi movie called Argo. They received help from experienced filmmakers such as makeup artist John Chambers, who helped conceal the diplomats' identities. January 28, 1980. Finally, after months of waiting, the six diplomats who evaded capture were returned home safely, while 53 hostages still remained in Iran.
Mr. President, Mr. Speaker, members of the 96th Congress, fellow citizens, this last few months has not been an easy time for any of us. The 1980s have been born in turmoil, strife, and change. This is a time of challenge to our interests and our values. At this time in Iran, 50 Americans are still held captive, innocent victims of terrorism and anarchy.
Nations in the Security Council, as well as other councils in the United Nations, began debating to reach a peaceful solution to the crisis.
The faces change, but the speeches are amazingly similar. The American hostages must be released. Iran must respect the traditional diplomatic immunity of foreign embassies. That seems to be the unanimous opinion of every country here. But while they express their public indignation, the Security Council is working equally hard behind the scenes to avoid doing or saying anything that might force Iran to take drastic action. The final wording of the Security Council resolution is still being worked on. The United States wants to make sure that it calls for the release of the hostages as a precondition to any other action.
With diplomatic debates dragging on, the United States decided it was time to take on the responsibility of the hostages' well-being. April 25th, 1980, Operation Eagle Claw.
Late yesterday, I canceled a carefully planned operation which was underway in Iran to position our rescue team for a later withdrawal of American hostages who've been held captive there since November 4th. Equipment failure in the rescue helicopters made it necessary to end the mission. As our team was withdrawing after my order to do so, two of our American aircraft collided on the ground following a refueling operation in a remote desert location in Iran. There was no fighting, there was no combat, but to my deep regret, eight of the crewmen of the two aircraft which collided were killed, and several other Americans were hurt in the accident.
July 11th, 1980. Due to his extenuating condition, hostage Richard Queen was released from captivity. 52 hostages, stripped of their basic human rights, still remain in Iran. July 27th, 1980. The Shah dies of cancer, leaving the terms of the hostages' release uncertain to the world. September 12th, 1980. After the Shah's death, the Ayatollah issues new terms for the hostages' release, revolving around the unfreezing of billions of dollars of Iranian assets. November 4th, 1980. 1 year in captivity.
Well, the time has come. You've seen the map. We've looked at the figures, and NBC News now makes its projection for the presidency. Reagan is our projected winner.
January 19th, 1981. With only months left in office, President Jimmy Carter was determined to end the Iran hostage crisis. Finally, after well over a year, the United States and Iran signed an agreement that guaranteed both the release of all of the hostages and the unfreezing of over $8 billion of Iranian assets. January 20th, 1981, 444 days of captivity.
Now, day one. Day one of Ronald Reagan's presidency, and day one of freedom for 52 Americans. Though thousands of miles apart, these two historic events moved almost on parallel tracks today. The new president had not been in office an hour when the former hostages became free men and women again.
Finally, just before Mr. Carter got to Andrews Air Force Base for his trip home to Plains, the hostages' departure was officially confirmed. They had taken off about a half an hour after he was no longer president. The timing could hardly have been accidental.